Welcome to CSL Dallas, a center for spiritual living. We are so glad you're here with us this morning. Thank you for being here. So if you have a moment, check in on social media. Kiss my brother. I danced too hard. Check in on social media. Give our Facebook page a like and also subscribe to our awesome YouTube channel for content throughout the week. All right, here we go. Our purpose statement, say with me, at CSL Dallas, we are all about being radically inclusive, spiritually progressive, and all about transforming lives. Yes. So we have some announcements. First of all, we have to take a moment to acknowledge Juneteenth. Let's talk about it. So on June 19th, 1865, Gordon Granger, a Union general, arrived in Galveston, Texas to inform enslaved African Americans of their freedom. That the Civil War has ended, and General Granger's announcement put into effect the Emancipation Proclamation, which had been issued more than 2.5 years earlier by President Abraham Lincoln. In thinking about Juneteenth today, it's a great example of how one person can make a difference. Juneteenth finally became a federal holiday, and it all happened because of the efforts of Candace Stowers' aunt, Fort Worth activist Opal Lee. Love it. So for decades, the 94-year-old Lee had advocated to have Juneteenth recognized as a national holiday. She raised money, started petitions, and in 2016, at the age of 89, she walked 1,400 miles from Fort Worth to Washington, D.C. to bring awareness to the celebration. She continued to walk 2.5 miles annually in Fort Worth to bring awareness to her cause. And on Thursday, 5 years after she made that initial journey, Lee stood alongside President Joe Biden as he signed the bill that made Juneteenth a national holiday. Yes! So, yesterday, Opal Lee said that she wasn't quite ready to stop the 2.5-mile walk, and here's why. She said, we're going to tackle housing, we're going to tackle joblessness, we're going to tackle healthcare, and we're going to tackle climate change. Wow. So never forget that one person can change the world. Wow. Speaking of changing the world and changing our campus, we have a restoration update. So we're super excited, you guys. Get ready. July 11th, that is the date we are officially opening our sanctuary again. We cannot wait to have you in the building. We miss your energy. We miss your love. And also, we're super excited about this. July 10th and July 11th, we have community-wide work parties. So let's talk about July 10th from 11 a.m. to 1 p.m. And then July 11th from 11:30 a.m. to 1:30, we're gonna get together, we're gonna have fun, and we get to put the final touches on our beautiful campus. Also, throughout this whole wonderful experience of restoration, we've been live streaming all over the country, but not just that. If you look at our Facebook numbers, we actually have people from all over the world watching CSL Dallas. And it's only possible because of you and your donation. So right now, you can donate on Facebook. The link is right below in the comments. And also donate at csldallas.org or text GIVE to 972-954-4404. Thank you for giving. Thank you, thank you, thank you.
Yes, and today is a special day. This is a day where we are bringing forward the masculine principles, that which is within all of us. It is causal, it is the choice, it is that seed of thought that says, yes, I want to direct in this direction. And that also means that we get to celebrate the fathers and the father figures in all of our lives, all of the men that have truly assisted in raising us up and supporting us and loving us and lifting us in the way in which they work and are part of the family and the extended families and the chosen families. So in this moment, all of us here in the CSL Dallas community especially want to give deep, sincere respect and honor for all of the fathers and the father figures in all of our lives and for all the previous generations that have birthed who we are and who we came here to be. So imagine the tens of thousands of us right here, right now, giving a huge standing ovation to you, our fathers and our father figures. We love you, we appreciate you, and we honor you. Happy Father's Day.
I invite you to go within. Stepping into that field of unconditional love that surrounds us, that uplifts us, that breathes us. It is the divine impulse of life itself. As you, as me, as the we that we are, together, join together, heart to heart, in this moment and every moment that we remember, there is only love. So whether we are celebrating Juneteenth and freedom, or whether we are celebrating Father's Day, and all the father figures, the brothers, the uncles, the mentors, the guides, the wisdom keepers, the visionaries. Each one is that impulse of love seeking to make itself known in the world. So resting in that truth, standing in that truth, that the divine impulse of love is the force of life, is the force of creation that binds us together despite any human condition or circumstance. We celebrate that truth in this moment. We honor it. We live from that place of embodying that unconditional love right here, right now. So how good it is to be in that place of love, to allow it to be all that it is meant to be as each one of us. So I call it good, and we affirm it together by saying Ashe, Amin, Aloha.
Aloha,
and so it is.
Follow.
Oscar and Cleo and our fabulous band and Kirby Welch. Woo! So it is, yes, absolutely. So I want to introduce to you Kirby and give you a little information, and then we're going to invite him to share a little bit of himself and his heart with you. So Kirby has 10 years of music ministry, including being an interim director. He's done singing and playing and arranging music of all types. In that arena. He has 5 years of experience as a drum and band teacher, an assistant director in junior high and high school, band, drum line, steel drums. He created a whole performance piece with the steel drums, which was amazing. I got to hear it. As you can see, his favorite instrument is the guitar, which we're truly excited about. He also plays the drums, the piano, and he does sing. But the guitar is his love, and if you go out on his Instagram page, you'll see amazing, amazing pieces that Kirby's put out there. He's written music, he arranges music, he loves to write music for people who have already written lyrics to a song, and he creates performances. He has a BA in music theory from UNT. And is on his own personal spiritual path. And so we were delighted that he found us and that we found him. And so he's been sharing his music with you last week and this week. And so, Kirby, we'd love to have you share a little bit of your thoughts and your heart with our community. Thanks for being here.
So good to be here. Good to be with you all this morning. Whenever I first started going to therapy, I had to make... I was given a values list, and it was this big, extensive 80 words, you know, things like courage, compassion, empathy, and she told me to pick two, which is really hard for somebody who doesn't like picking very few things. And the two that I landed on in particular were authenticity and creativity. Those seem to be two of the things that I strive for the most in my life. And when I found the job posting for CSL Dallas, I couldn't help but feel like, wow, this is a place where I will be allowed to be my authentic self, my creative self. And I think that those two values are something that I hope to instill in others as well. I find it very important that we engage in creativity and not necessarily even just in an artistic way. I think creativity can play out in lots of ways. I think a lot of my perspective is coming more from the instrumental realm of education. And so I'm excited to see what instrumentalists are out there in our communities. I'm excited to see what kind of, you know, weird watercolored scarf knitting, whatever it is that you're into. I want to know about it, man. I want to hear about it. I want to know all of it. Because I find that when we are engaging with our creative selves, we really are connecting to who we really are. And I feel like a lot of my vision really came into fruition whenever I got a chance to finally see this building. And I'm so excited for June 11th and so excited for us to finally be in this space, finally ready to see your lovely faces instead of you only seeing mine. It feels very one-sided at the moment. And so I'm very much looking forward to that and seeing what kind of fun community activities we can put together. And yes, I'm just very, very excited for the future.
So let's say thank you to Kirby. We're truly excited about Kirby being here. You will have an opportunity to provide feedback after last week and this week, just your thoughts and feelings about all of that. And Kirby has two beautiful songs he's going to share with us. And interestingly enough, both of them are songs that we play for my granddaughter. Which is really cool. When I found both of them, I was like, oh my God, I love this music. And, you know, I'm always astonished, why is it that we're willing to teach things to our children that it seems we forget as adults? So, thanks, Kirby. Thanks for being here. And thanks for our beautiful band, Brad, Jonathan, and Matt.
If this life is one act, why do we lay all these traps? We put them right in our path when we just wanna be free. I will not waste my days making up all kinds of ways to worry about all those things that will not happen to me. So I just let go of what I know I don't know. I know I only do this by living in the moment, living my life, easy and breezy, peace in my mind, peace in my heart, peace in my soul. Wherever I'm going, I'm already home, living in the moment. Letting myself off the hook for things I've done. I let my past go past, and now I'm having more fun. I'm letting go of the thoughts that do not make me strong. And I believe this way can be the same for everyone. And if I fall asleep, I know you'll be the one. My life, easy and breezy, with peace in my mind, with peace in my heart, peace in my soul. Wherever I'm going, I'm I'm already home. And I can't walk through life facing backwards. I have tried more than once to just make sure. And I've just denied the future I've been searching for. But I spun around and heard no more. Now I'm living in a moment, living my life, easy and breathing, peace in my mind. Oh, peace in my heart, peace in my soul. Wherever I'm going, I'm already home. Oh, I'm living in a moment, living my life, living my easy and breezy, peace in my mind, peace in my heart, peace in my soul. Wherever I'm going, I'm already home.
Thank you so much, Kirby. Thank you, Brad, Jonathan, and Matt. Living in the moment. I love that song. And yeah, isn't that just sometimes almost impossible to do? Right? What pulls you out of the moment? For me, it's all the conversations going on in my head, isn't it? All the conversations that we're having about what we're supposed to be doing tomorrow, or what we didn't do yesterday, or what we should be doing right in the moment, right? So we're talking about being pulled by the vision this month, and the title of today's talk is to free your mind and the rest will follow. Well, we have to free our minds from this incessant conversation that's going on. We have to free our minds from this incessant, I don't know about you, what do you have up there? I have a committee. First of all, my committee sounds like my critical mother. It sounds like my demanding father. It sounds like all the ways in which I don't measure up to how I would like to be. I've actually named them. I have critical Carla and anxious Amber. I have pitiful Pearl. Oh, do I have pitiful Pearl? Oh, my God. I have worry wart. Every once in a while, even up there, it's a little bit of sarcasm, which is my guilty pleasure, and I never let it come out of my mouth. But I sure do think it sometimes. And it's all going on at the same time, right? Isn't that? And that's part of what keeps us from living in the moment and being present with our own lives, being present with the truth of who we came here to be, and quite frankly, being present to any contribution that we're going to make, right? I don't know how many times I've talked myself out of this whole idea that I, as a one person, can make a difference. Right? Because critical Carla gets in there, and pitiful Pearl gets in there, and then worry wart, and all of that gets in there. And we just stop ourselves from actually allowing the vision to pull us, whether it's a personal vision about our own lives, or whether it's a vision about how we want to see the world shifting and changing, and the healing that we want to see for our planet, right? All of this stuff can get in the way. And so we have to free our minds. We have to free our minds. Now, this is not new. Actually, there's very little new that's about new thought. The idea is that we have to have a new thought about things. And we have to see it from a different point of view. So from the teachings of Jesus, we get the truth shall set you free. The truth shall set you free. And from Paul, we get be transformed by the renewing of your mind. From the science of mind, we get change your thinking, change your life. So these are the things that we want to focus on a little bit this morning, because they do give us a roadmap. They give us a roadmap on how we can rest our mind and allow the rest of it to follow. Free our minds and allow the rest of it to follow. So the first one is, I want to give you this quote from Ernest Holmes. This is from this thing called You. Your soul belongs to the universe. Your mind is an outlet through which the creative intelligence of the universe seeks fulfillment. Well, that's a lovely thought, except that if I have my committee working, there's no space, right? There's no outlet through which in creative intelligence can work. I can't listen to my intuition. I can't hear the little nudge. I can't have the moment of revelation or download some new piece of information, right? And I am clearly thinking about my human foibles instead of the spiritual truth. The truth shall set us free. The truth that we belong to the universe. We are actually an outlet for life, for the creative intelligence of the universe. Evolution has created a beautiful universe in which we live. Consciousness has grown something really amazing. And one of the things that consciousness has grown is an organ that can become self-conscious, self-aware of consciousness. And now to participate. Now it's our job. What are we going to evolve from here, personally and collectively? What are we going to contribute to evolution, to the ongoing unfoldment of the beauty of life? That's the truth. Not only what are we going to, but almost more importantly, are we going to take responsibility for that? I also love when it says the truth will set you free, but it'll hurt first. I just hate that part. I hate that part, right? Take responsibility for the fact that I am an outlet of creative intelligence. Am I actually in alignment with spiritual truth, or am I just allowing my mind to run amok? Or am I finding myself drawn to, well, if only I had that thing, then I would be happy. If only it would be this way, then I would be happy. Right? All of the games and things that we play with ourselves. The truth will set us free, but it may hurt first. We may have to take responsibility for the fact that we are an outlet through which creative intelligence of the universe seeks fulfillment. I mean, what an extraordinary thing. Do you understand that's how important you are? And that's how big the purpose of our lives is, to be that and to do that the way that we individually and uniquely do that. The truth will set us free. It sets us free from the limitations of our humanness, of the ways in which we hold ourselves back, the littleness that we feel about ourselves. It sets us free from our critical nature of others. It sets us free from, well, this is just the way it's always been. I don't know how it's ever going to change. Well, if I'm 89 and start walking to Washington, D.C., I mean, that's like that. We could all be inspired by that lack of allowing human limitation to hold us back. We are responsible to our purpose, to be an outlet for creative intelligence. The truth will set us free. That's the truth of who we are. So that's the first piece of freeing our minds. Is to move into the truth and to stop telling ourselves the limited story of our past. I love this quote. Trying to change physical conditions without changing my consciousness is like trying to change the reflection in the mirror without changing the object causing the reflection. Life is simply reflecting back to us, individually and collectively, what we think and believe about life and this truth that is setting us free, the truth about the nature of reality. And so if we want to change the outer circumstances, we actually have to change what's standing in front of the mirror, which is the renewing of our minds. Be transformed by the renewing of our minds, to renew our consciousness in alignment with our spiritual truth. Okay, I'm going to ask you, this is a really stupid question, but just do this thought experiment with me. Pretend you're standing in front of the mirror, right? You're getting ready to go out. Maybe you're going to go out on a date. Maybe you're going to go out for a nice dinner. Maybe you're going to go for something really special and you think, wait, my hair's not quite right. Do you actually stand there and try to comb the hair in the mirror? Stupid, right? You don't comb the hair in the mirror. You comb your own hair. And what happens? The mirror's reflection shifts. And all of a sudden you go, oh, that looks good. I'm ready to go. And yet, what we tend to do in our lives is we're constantly trying to comb the hair of everything that's going on around us, as if somehow that's going to make the permanent change. No, it is an internal change. It is that which is standing in front of the mirror. And if we want life to mirror something differently back to us, we have to renew our minds over and over and over again with spiritual truth, with that which is beautiful and just and good, healthy. We have to show ourselves, seek evidence for all the ways in which life is good, is growing. People are doing amazing things, like walking 1,400 miles at 89 years old. These are the extraordinary things that we want to pay attention to. This is what we want to put in front of the mirror so that we can renew and rewrite the very synaptic pathways in our brain. That's what we're doing. It's not magic. It's not mystical. We're not trying to do anything to God. We're changing our consciousness. We're changing the very synaptic pathways of our brain to focus on spiritual truth, to insist upon it, to look for it, and to begin to see it revealed back to us. And as we renew our minds over and over and over again, the mirror begins to change. How long has the conversation been about Juneteenth? How long? And ultimately and eventually the conversation changes, because who's standing in front of the mirror has changed. The shift in consciousness to inclusivity, to celebrating diversity, to seeing that spiritual truth, that's what changes. It starts by renewing our minds. We have to see the truth, let it set us free, and then be willing to have that renew our minds. The last thing we want to talk about then is this lovely quote by Paramahansa Yogananda. And it is this: most people consider the course of events as natural and inevitable. They little know what radical changes are possible through prayer. So we don't often use the term prayer. We tend to use the term spiritual mind treatment. It is a way of seeing the truth, speaking the truth, and renewing our minds. And prayer, affirmative prayer, any kind of prayer that aligns us with spiritual truth is what begins to develop that entire consciousness, that entire revelation of spiritual truth as it pours through us. Remember, we're the outlet for creative intelligence. We're the outlet for love. We're the outlet. It's not about getting love. It's not about getting all of the things that we want. It's about being it and letting it out, standing in front of the mirror, and the mirror must then reflect back to us. And so we use our spiritual work, we use prayer, we use our spiritual mind treatment, not to change anything out there, but to shift our consciousness into that deep and abiding truth. So we talk about spiritual mind treatment. We talk about spiritual mind treatment as a way of getting unstuck from emotional reactions, getting unstuck and out of biased thinking, moving beyond our limitation and fear into an entirely new mindset. And it is that mindset that changes everything. Why? I guess because of a mindset. We use that term mind and thought and intelligence as if it's like somehow connected to our linear rational brain. No, we're talking about consciousness, the mind, heart, and even the gut, right? We know there are brain cells in the mind, the heart, and the gut. And so we should say in the brain, the heart, and the gut. That's our mind. That's the totality of our mind and the totality of our consciousness. And so our spiritual work through this technology we call spiritual mind treatment is aligns all of that, shifts all of that into alignment with spiritual truth so that we can be freed by that truth and renew our mind so that our consciousness is shifted so that our life begins to truly reflect it and change happens. So, spiritual mind treatment, spiritual because it's based on the infinite nature of life. Mind because it is directly involved with the use of consciousness and most importantly that all that crap that's back there in the subconscious. And treatment because it's like taking a pill for your consciousness. It's like deciding to do a treatment on our own consciousness so that we can grow, so that we can remake ourselves into alignment with the spiritual truth of what we believe. Our treatment is so that we can cure our consciousness from the illusion and the false reality and bring ourselves into alignment with truth. So spiritual mind treatment, kind of a weird way of saying it, but it has this profound implication. And so, so Ernest Holmes says it this way. We're going to talk about just a couple of things. This is from The Science of Mind. What does spiritual mind treatment do? It opens in an avenue of thought, expands consciousness, and lets reality through. It clarifies the mentality, removes the obstruction of thought, and lets in the light, right? We're creating that avenue through which spiritual truth, creative intelligence, we're opening the outlet for creative intelligence to move. Treatment is not for the purpose of making things happen. It is to provide within ourselves an avenue through which they may happen. Yes? Yes. Treatment removes doubt and fear, lets in the realization of the presence of spirit, and is necessary while we are confronted by obstructions or obstacles. Let's be clear. Life, it has obstructions and obstacles, right? It's a journey. It's a path, and there are pebbles, and there are boulders, and there's torrential rain and streams to cross, right? There are challenges and obstacles. But it is when we engage with our spiritual technology and we do our work in consciousness that all of that becomes part of the journey and we become a creative outlet and an inspiration for others. We get to help people over the boulder because maybe we've learned how to get over it ourselves, or somebody's on the other side and they're reaching their hand for us. Right? That's true both in physical reality and it's true in consciousness. Our spiritual mind treatment moves us and allows us the confidence to move through the obstacles and challenges, not the pretense that there aren't going to be any. Finally, we find in The Science of Mind this idea that we already live in a perfect universe, but this needs to be seen before it can become part of our experience. If all we're ever doing is collecting evidence about how it's not working, then that's what we're standing in front of the mirror with. And that is what the mirror reflects back to us. So we have to see in our mind's eye that which we want to see as part of our experience. The origin of every problem is ultimately to be found within us. And the answer to every problem will be discovered in spiritual realization. It is the spiritual truth that sets us free. It renews our mind and it gives us that place where we can stand in front of the mirror. We can change our thinking and change our life. So if you want to learn more about this, we do this in all of our classes. I highly recommend you think about getting into Foundations class in the fall. It'll start in September. Lots and lots and lots of classes. Actually, the truth is, everything we teach here is designed to do exactly this, and to teach you about spiritual mind treatment as this profound technology that helps us to do that. And then, when we do that, regardless of the obstacles and challenges, we can know life is beautiful. It's a lovely day, every day, that we allow ourselves to be inspired by that spiritual realization. And that's the reason why we play this song, Karen and I play this song to our granddaughter so often, because it not only reminds her, it reminds us of this spiritual truth. Free your mind, free your mind. It is actually a lovely day.
When I wake up in the morning, love, and the sunlight hurts my eyes, and there's something without warning, love, bears heavy on my mind. Then I look at you, and the world's alright with me. Just one look at you, and I know it's gonna be a lovely day. A lovely day, a lovely day, lovely day. When the day that lies ahead of me seems impossible to face, when someone else instead of me always seems to know the way, world's all right with me. Oh, just one look at you, and I know it's gonna be a lovely day. The day that lies ahead of me seems impossible to face, and when someone else instead of me always seems to know the way, then I look at you, and the world's all right with me. Oh, just one look at you, and I know it's gonna be.
It is a lovely day for everything within this universe is winking and is alive with its highest and greatest potentiality. All of life on this planet is awake and aware to this lovely day. From quarks to shooting stars to the rings of Saturn, to all that is in this universe shining bright. And here we each are, right now, showing up as this life. This one life, this one love that is boundless. This one power that is a force to be reckoned with. So I invite you right now to go within yourself, that vast spaciousness. And in your mind's eye, stand in front of the mirror of life itself. And smile. Not like perhaps is normally done in front of a mirror. Smile at the magnificence, the radiance, the presence, the sparkle, the joy, the creativity, the love, the peace, the affection. And embrace yourself. And how magnificent in all of the universe, in all of times before and times to come, we might be quirky, but this is the only time that life itself chose to show up as you, as me, as us. So I speak the word for each of us, that we within each of our own selves smile in repose for all the good that we've each done and are in our own lives, in the lives of all of us around us. How we show up sometimes when we don't want to. How we keep going no matter the obstacles, the situations, the circumstances, because we're here breathing right now as life. And I know for each of us that the truth that we are an individualized expression of this one life, never to show up again, sets us free, quiets the voices, stops them from chattering and nattering. And that there is truly a renewing of our mind, that we look for the good that lies within each of us. We look for the good in how we show up, and that good is good enough. This is the vision that pulls us, and we smile inside our own selves. We love ourselves inside our own selves. Right here, right now. And so I release these words into the universal law, that law that knows how to produce this smile. I am enough. I am the goodness of life itself showing up right here and right now. And so it is.
I am super pumped about these awesome classes that we have coming your way. So first of all, June 27th, Keys to spiritual practice. So if you're new to Science of Modern, new to CSL Dallas, this is the absolute class to start with. So again, it's June 27th. So this is about choice. It's actually a choice to raise your conscious awareness and create new experiences and conditions in your life. So if you're new, you gotta take this course. It is incredible. And also we have the Parable of the Sower book study based on the best-selling book by Octavia Butler. This starts July 10th and it goes for 3 weeks, taught by the incredible, the glorious Tracy Brown. So let's talk about what this course is about. This course will explore the challenge of applying spiritual principles during times of change, disruption, and transformation. It sounds like 2021. So this book was published in 1993 and is set in the 2020s and imagines society, Earthseed, that is falling apart due to climate change, corporate greed, and economic inequality. What?
Prophetic.
Oh my gosh. Okay, so. So, wow. So we get to learn about this fictional religion, Earthseed, and how it aligns with metaphysical principles that we teach here in Science of Mind, and how the challenges faced by the characters in the book share many parallels with 21st century America. I'm freaking out about this. Wow. So July 10th goes for 3 weeks. Check it out. All the information is at csldallas.org. And as you know, we are one step closer to having a new music director, so we would love your input. At the end of the service, please check out the link spiritualcenter.me/Kirby and let us know all your thoughts. It's amazing. In closing, we also have our practitioners and our licensed spiritual coaches on standby for you right now on Zoom. You get a one-on-one private room to work on spiritual mind treatment and manifest what you want to see in your life. So please take advantage. Now we're going to sing it out. We're going to dance it out with Grateful together.
Moment.